go straight into the word, if you will. Go with me to Genesis. Genesis 1:28. I'm going to start right there. I love your theme, Bishop and Apostle. And I concur with your vision of what God is saying to you here and what God is saying in this season, because God has been dealing with me. He's been dealing with me about the family. Amen. About the family. So. And for those of you that know me, I am a teacher.
Amen.
I can preach.
Yes.
And I will preach.
Hey.
Hallelujah. Go ahead now.
But in all our getting, we want to get an understanding. So we're talking about the family. Family consists of parents and children living together in a household. The concept of family is extremely important in the Bible, both in the physical sense and in a theological sense. The concept of family was introduced in the very beginning. That's where I pick up the scripture, Genesis 1:28. God blessed them, and he said to them, be fruitful, increase in number, fill the earth, and subdue it.
Yeah.
Rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and over every living creature that moves on the earth.
Hallelujah.
Also want to go to Genesis 2:24.
Yeah.
Now we know in Genesis 2:24, God is talking about the union of marriage.
Yeah.
So God's plan was for marriage so that we could procreate, so that we can increase, so that we can enlarge and expand. So this is essential. The family is God's essential building block of society. But as we move through the Bible of Genesis, we found out and we find out that there are horrors within the family. We see polygamy in the family. We see adultery. We see incest. We see so much in the family that comes to contaminate the family. But all is not lost. Tell someone all is not lost. You may be seen. All is not lost. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We praise you. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you such as we are, God. God, we come before you seeking a word for your people, God. Lord, we ask that you crucify the flesh, that you may be manifest, that your anointing will take root, and that you will tear down every stronghold, and that you will destroy everything that's not like you. God, I touch and agree with my brothers and sisters around this room, that you be glorified, that you be edified, that flesh will not be seen, but you will get the glory and the honor from this world, so that we may rise up and become the frontliners of your kingdom, God. Lord, we thank you, and we praise you, and we count it all done in your son Jesus' name. Amen. So I said all is not lost when it comes to the family. And Bishop, you talked about your natural family, and we all have links to our natural family.
Amen.
And it's a good thing. It's a good thing. You know, there's a lot of dysfunction in our natural family. If we tell it like it is, I don't mind telling it like it is, because there's dysfunction in all of our families. There was dysfunction in the body of Christ as well. In the beginning, there was dysfunction. I talk about the incest. I talk about the polygamy. I talk about the adulterous affairs. All of this is conducive to the family unit, such as it is today. But then God comes to bridge the gap. He sent his son that we may have life and have life more abundantly.
Yes.
Not that God wasn't concerned about your physical family. However, God wanted, and in Matthew, God began to say, he's in there with the crowd, and he's dealing with the people, and they come to him and they say, your father, your mother and your brothers are outside, and they want to see you. And he looked in the crowd and he says, who is my mother? Who is my brother? Those that do the Father's will are my brothers and my sisters. So away the focus of the natural family, but he wanted us to see a deeper theological understanding of what the family really was. And the weight of the kingdom family. I look around this room and I've got brothers and sisters I've never met. I met them online and I say, thank you, God, for your kingdom spirit. Amen. And I look at you as you come in. I can identify with those fine jewels and those diamonds because as I've sat here, I saw several things. I saw people that are weak on the battlefield. I saw you came in bruised. I saw you came in discouraged. Oh, yes, you put your church face on and you dressed up in your church apparel, but I pulled back. I pulled back all those layers. Oh, yes, they call us pastors. Oh, yes, they call us teachers. Oh, yes, they call us ministers. Oh, yes, they call us apostles. But you don't know the cause of my oil. Oh, son of the ashay. Just this week, I was just walking through my house and sometimes I was creeping through it because I felt the pain racking my body. And I looked to heaven and I said, God, very few people know the cost of my oil. There's somebody. There's oil. There's oil in you. And there's a cost you have to pay. You know, sometimes we'll feel some type of way when people being used in the kingdom of God and when they're anointed to do the work of the kingdom. And sometimes we'll feel like God has forsaken us. Tell somebody you don't know the cost of my oil. Ah, glory to God. But I'm talking to the family. God is calling the family. He says in Luke, he says, I came to the brokenhearted. Is there any brokenhearted in this place?
Analogies. I'm looking at the lame man. Y'all know he was born lame. Okay, so
He was born lame. He was born broken. Amen. So every day they would pick him up and take him to the gate called Beautiful. So he could bear arms. Come on, somebody. Some of y'all are still being carried to the gate. Come on, somebody. But one thing about the gate, you don't get to go in. One thing about the gate, you don't get to sup at the table. I don't know about you, but I don't like when they're chopping. If I don't have what it takes to go in, honey, I will stay home. Because I want what's on the inside.
Come on.
But some of y'all are laying at the gate of Beautiful. And you're still bearing up. Can I get a little bit of that? Can you pray for me? Can you give me a little something, something into payday? But we don't know the magnitude of the oil on the inside of us.
Yes.
So here he is, and he's begging on. Amen. So the disciples came. And they said, silver and gold I have none. But such as I have. They to call him forth. They didn't pray for him. They just spoke him forth. Yo, we got power to speak people forth. We don't have to be in church all night long. So that spirit took root. But the Bible said that God came that you may have Mephibosheth, he wasn't excited because he still lived under the fear of what Saul had done. So that all the days of his life, he was living in fear. That's just like some of us. Wonder when they're going to take it back. Wonder when it's going to dry up. It's too good to be for real. So the Bible said he lived under fear for 15 years. After that, imagine the years you've lived under fear. Imagine the years you forfeit your father's covenant. David and Jonathan had a covenant together. But Jesus had a covenant with us. He says we're the apple of his eye. He says that greater work shall we do. I want to get in here and show you what he says. Saul tells someone, we are family. John 1 and 12 said, yet to all who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of the natural descent, nor of human decision, but born of God. Then Romans 8 and 15 says, we were born of Christ. So when he's talking about we're not born of the natural, but we're born by the Spirit, not Jews or Gentiles, but we're born of the Spirit. So what he's saying here, we were born physically into a physical family. But when we're born again, we are reborn to a spiritual family. Tell somebody, I've got a new daddy. Oh, y'all better get this today. I've got a new daddy. And the Bible says I'm joined heirs with Jesus Christ. So everything that belongs to him belongs to me. The Bible says we are a descendant of Abraham. The Bible said that God decreed and declared that the blessings of the Abraham would make him rich and have no sorrow. The Bible said that Abraham would be the father to many nations. Tell him I've got a new daddy. Glory to God. Galatians 3:23. The spiritual family is not bound to ethnicity. Nor gender or social standing. So Paul picks it up in Galatians 3:26. He said, you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you were baptized in Christ. You have been clothed with Christ. There is neither Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then I say again, you are the heirs of Abraham, the heirs according to promise. Tell someone, I've got something coming my way.
Somebody,
you said it, honey, when you were saved. I come to get mine. I come to get mine because I've got something waiting for me. Amen. Glory to God. Let me give you another story. I want this to resonate with you. So Revelation 7:9 said, the family draws from every nation. Yo, we've got friends and we've got family in every nation. See, that's why Wake Up Call radio and television broadcast was birthed. Because I realize this thing is bigger than me. We've got family in other nations. We got them in every tribe. We got them in every language. Oh my God, we've got family everywhere. So if we got family, we have to see about our family. So he says, a new commandment have I given you. Love one another as I've loved you. So by this, people will know that I am a child of God because of the love. I can love you without even knowing you. We touch and agree right at the door. I even gave you a spot on our radio and television show just by touching and agreeing with you. That baby back there that just sang, I want your CD to play on our network. Deliverance. Joel 2:25 says, I will restore the years. See, that's what I want to dig at right now. The years, the kingdom worm and the palm of worms are stolen from you. Come on, y'all. I've been through the storm too. Oh, come on, somebody. If it had not been for God on my side, I would have given up a long time ago. I remember when I didn't even want to live. I remember when I didn't have a will to live. I didn't have a purpose to live. But one day, I woke up and I'm here. I'm here beckoning you to get up. Come up out of your grave. God is calling you, Lazarus. He says, come forth.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Get up out of your graves of depression, your grains of frustration, brokenness, come on out. Anybody willing to come out today? Oh, come on, somebody. I say, God, here am I, and I'm standing in the need. Lord, if you said my song this morning, you said whatever you're doing in this season, God, don't do it without me. I want to be in this season. I want to be in this great movement, because he says, greater work shall we do. Y'all know it's not by happenstance that all these ministers are here. It's not by happenstance that all of you are here for such a time as this. See, I don't get moved by numbers, because I know that God orchestrates everything from the beginning to the end. God knew you would be right here in the house of transformation, September the 3rd. He knew that you would be here with your cups up before him.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
God is trying to take us out of the limelight of just wanting to be a copy. Of other ministries. See, God called me because he know I don't have any good sense. He know I'll say whatever he has for me to say, and when he's done, I'll sit down and I'll act as if I don't have nothing to say. Because I understand the price of my oil.
Come on, Lord God.
Tell somebody we are family.
Family.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Want to bring your attention to another group here. Want to talk about David a little further.
Yeah.
The Bible said that was in Ziklag. Come on, somebody. Because see, if you can't relate just yet, maybe this will bring it home for you. But David and the men were in Ziklag. Glory to God. Amen. They were out there doing what they're supposed to do. And so when they reached their hometown, the Bible says that the home was burned down. They could see it from afar. They saw the smoke. Come on, somebody. They saw the smoke. And when they reached the home, they couldn't find their children.
Yeah.
They couldn't find the other men's children and wives.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the Bible said that the men were so angry and distraught, they wanted to kill me. They wanted to kill David. But I love what David said, and I want you to understand why he said it. And I want you to understand why God says, David is a man after my own heart. Because the Bible said that David consulted the Lord.
Yes,
amen.
And the Bible says that God told David, well, first David asked God, should I go and recover or should I just leave it alone?
Come on.
I had an incident. Lots of life-changing incidents happened in the last few months. And everybody was looking for me to react a different way. But I had to go consult God. They said, but the loss is great. I said, I've got to consult God.
Because
I heard God say that.
All right.
I told my husband, I said, you know, God can get and we're going to take everything that you stole. The reason I get out to my fight every day is because I remember what he took from me. I remember how I felt. So when I get up to go into my fight, I said, I'm taking back everything the devil stole. And I'm coming with a vision.
Say about you.
Yes.
has to have a publishing company. You have music to produce. You have books to produce. You need to go back and have a conversation with yourself.
Jesus.
Say, God, what is the last?
Amen.
I'm supposed to leave in the earth. God didn't leave you here 80 years, 70 years, 50 years just to exist. He left you to impact the world.
Amen.
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 So
Amen.
What is that legacy? Tell them it's time to attack. To recover. Come on, y'all.
Amen.
It's time out for just putting on. The church is just putting on, y'all.
Amen.
Going through the motion. That's why it takes so long to feel the anointing of God. Because we know how to be churchy. We know how to wear the right attire. We know how to jump to the right beat. But God says no more church as usual. You've heard that. No more church as usual. I want my babies to see a difference. I want them to take on to my legacy and carry it to the next level. That's what we're supposed to do. Glory to God. Come on, let us experience. Grab someone next to you. Tell them we're family. Hello, brother. Hello, sister. We're family. Ooh, I love my family. And God sent us here to have a family reunion. Don't you like when you go to a reunion and you meet people you've never met? You get to talk about the things that you're doing, and they get to talk about the things that they're doing. We're family. They found us on the internet. Amen. Preaching to the multitude. Right in our dining room, just like we were preaching in cathedrals. Because it does not matter. Honey, I've been there, done that. Amen. Had the big, beautiful church, had the three businesses. Glory to God. And I remember one day God said, what would you do if one day all of this would be more? We live right next to the church in the parsonage, just bought this big, beautiful church. $350,000. It was beautiful. Got our daycare, making hundreds of thousands of dollars with our senior and disabled adults. I could walk out of my back door right into the church, to my office, to preach. One day I was in the laundry room and I was ironing my husband's shirt. And the Holy Spirit said, what would you do? Because at this point, the church was expanding. It was really expanding. And so the cars would be on our lawn because so many people were coming. And God said, what would you do if one day this all ceased to exist? And I said to him, with the tears running down my face, I said, God, I would still serve you. Yeah. 16 years later, I'm still serving
you.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. So you have to make that commitment. What shall separate you from the love of God? Shall money, fame, fortune? Amen. What other people say? What will separate you? You've got to make a stand. And when you make a stand, Satan gets angry. And what I see here today, people have lost their enthusiasm. You've lost your joy. You've lost your love. We cannot operate in this type of world without enthusiasm, without joy, without faith. But the enemy has entrapped you. And you're so used to it until you say, well, God's just blessing her because, she's always at the church. Well, what about what you're saying to God late in the midnight? And the Bible said he don't have any respectable persons. Amen. God don't play favorite.
That's right.
God is a fair God and he's a just God. But if you want something from him, you have to be present in the moment, in the season. Come on, you can't be present with pulling stuff from the past.
That's right.
You got to say, I'm letting it go, even when the tears are rolling down your face. Like that incident last week, I said, I'm letting it go over $85,000 and tell me I have lost. I said, I am letting it go. They said, what about the heir that's attached to it? I said, it's in my heart and the devil cannot have it. Because the memory of it is in my heart. But the love of God extends even the more. But you have to be persistent, steadfast, and unmovable. Find that thing, find that area in which God has called you and purposed you to, and stay with it. Amen. We produce radio and television shows, not only for ourselves, but for our partners. Different places, different states, different countries. That's what we're doing. You know why? Because I've met the plan and purpose of God for my life, for this season. Had I held on to the last season, I would have missed God. But I remember years ago before we left that church, I saw me in the clouds, and I was hovering over the big, beautiful church. And I said, what is this? He said, your anointing cannot be contained in this place. I didn't quite understand it right then, but I'm understanding it now as we share the word abroad. It was too small for the vision that God had for me.
That's right.
So check in today. Check back in. You can check back, but check back in. Amen. And ask God, what is it that you have needed? Should I pursue this or should I go on? Because if you are detained, you're holding up the plan and the promise and your destiny. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. We praise you. We praise you for just being God. Thank you for being our Father. Thank you, God, that you promised you would never leave us, nor would you forsake us. You would be with us until the end of the world. We thank you for every gift, every talent. We thank you for the call that you place upon our lives, God. And Lord, I came today to do that which you have commanded me to do. And that was to be a midwife. To help people push their anointings, their callings, and their gifts. Lord, I thank you right now for all the mighty anointed people. Y'all, if y'all can see what I'm seeing right now, your anointing outweighs this building. My gosh. If you could just see as I see now and as God sees. And if you could just put all that mess, cast it down at his feet today. For the prophets, the pastors, the evangelists, the teachers, the apostles, and even the bishop, God. Lord, we know that this is not our doing, but it's your doing to make this ultimate connection.